Hey guys, a very good evening to all of you. So welcome to another video. In this video, I'm going to talk about variation theorem, like the title suggests. And variation theorem basically will teach you that life or science in general, like we say, science is all about facts. It's not that great, okay? Science is also about educated guess. It's also about intuition. Intuition plays a big role in science. So the next time someone suggests to you that science is all about facts and there's no guessing in science, well, tell them about variation theorem, okay? And we'll find out why am I saying this for variation theorem. Now, if you haven't seen my video on perturbation theory, I would request you to click this link over here and go and watch my video on perturbation theory, because here I'm going to make certain comparisons between variation theorem and perturbation theory. So why do we need variation theorem? See, already we have discussed about perturbation theory. See, life in general is not that kind to us, okay? So we will not always get systems for which an ideal system is already known, right? For example, if I talk about perturbation theory, in perturbation theory we took the example of anharmonic oscillator. So anharmonic oscillator is basically a small perturbation or small change from the simple harmonic oscillator, and we know the exact solution for a simple harmonic oscillator. Or similarly, we know the exact solution for a hydrogen atom, okay? So from that we can try and approximate the energy of helium atom, because there is not much difference in both the systems, okay? It is a small perturbation from the ideal system. But let's say there's a system where the perturbation is either very large, or there's no such system for us which is known through which we can calculate the energy of the system, of the system that we need to calculate the energy. There's no ideal system which is even close to it. It's a very complicated system, let's say. So over there, the perturbation theory would not come to our rescue. So over there, what we have to do, we have to use variation theorem. So what does variation theorem say? Variation theorem basically states that you need to use a trial wave function or an ansatz wave function, okay? Ansatz or trial wave function, ansatz. Trial, I hope you all must have heard about trial wave function. And SATS is basically educated guess. Basically, it's a word which means educated guess or an educated assumption. So it's called an ansatz wave function or a trial wave function. It's nothing but a guess wave function, okay? But since we are scientists, if we say it's a guess wave function, you know, it will not reflect well upon the scientific community. That's why we just give it a name, trial wave function or an ansatz wave function. In reality, it's just an educated guess. It's a guess that you make out of intuition. So you make a guess about a trial wave function which depends on certain parameters, okay? And you vary these parameters to find out the minimum energy that you get. You vary the parameter to find out the minimum energy, okay? So let's say I'll plot a graph over here, okay? Let's say this is the parameter over here on the x-axis, and on the y-axis we have the energy. So we have some trial wave function phi which depends on some parameter p. So what do? We vary this parameter using this trial wave function, and wherever we get this minima, we say this is the closest energy that we have got to the original energy of the system. So let's say there's a system for which we cannot find out the exact solution, so we have to find the approximate solution. So what do we say? That this is the closest that we have reached to the exact solution of the approximate system for which we are approximating the energy, okay? Now, what does variation theorem also state? It's a very important fact that no matter what kind of trial wave function you take, and no matter how much you vary the parameters, you will never be able to get the energy. This is the formula for calculating the energy, where phi is your trial wave function. So this is the formula to calculate the energy. So the trial wave function, no matter what you take, which obeys the boundary conditions of the system. So if you are talking about particle in a 1D box, the boundary conditions are: the potential should be infinity outside the box, that is from L to, the potential should be zero from L to zero. So if it obeys the boundary conditions, whatever trial function we are taking, let's say we are trying to approximate the energy of a particle in 1D box, so whatever trial wave function we take, that should obey the boundary conditions, and that should be a well-behaved wave function. That should be a well-behaved quantum mechanical wave function. So provided these two conditions are met, whatever trial wave function we take, that will never have an energy lesser than the energy of the original system, okay? So for a particle in the ground state, what is the energy? h square by 8 ml square, that is the original energy of the ground state energy of the particle in 1D box, that we know for sure. So whatever energy we calculate using any trial wave function, that will always be greater than or equal to the original energy. It cannot be lesser than that. This is what your variation theorem states, and you will find the derivation of this fact in many books, okay? You can find it. So I'm not teaching you the derivation over here, that how this factor comes in the picture. If by any chance you are able to prove this wrong, okay, if you can take any trial function and you can prove that the approximate that the energy of the original system that is there, you got an energy lesser than that using a trial wave function, basically you have proven the whole quantum mechanics wrong, okay. But that is almost next to impossible, okay. I would not say impossible, that is next to impossible. Maybe hundreds of thousands of years in the future, maybe we can prove quantum mechanics wrong as well, or maybe in the near future also. But as of now, I don't think there is any threat to quantum mechanics, okay. So anyway, if you can find out a trial wave function such that the trial wave functions, if you calculate using this and the energy of the system comes out to be more than what you have calculated, well, you have just proved quantum mechanics wrong, okay. So anyway, now variation theorem has some certain drawbacks. The first drawback, like I told you, is we can reach a minima, okay, but the problem is that we don't know how close we are to the original energy, okay. There's no way for us to know how close we are to the original energy of the system for which we are approximating the energy. That is a very big problem with variation theorem, okay. So what we can do is we can keep assuming different trial wave functions, and whatever trial wave function gives us the lowest energy, we say we have reached close to the original system, but we cannot know how close we are to the original system. That is one drawback, okay. The second drawback was for the excited states, this variation theorem cannot be used for excited states, okay. It can be used for ground state, but cannot be used for excited states. So for excited states, we needed to vary this variation theorem, and that's where the concept of linear variation theorem came into the existence, okay. Linear variation theorem. So what does linear variation theorem states? That whatever the trial wave function we have, that can be written as a linear combination of n independent wave functions, okay. A trial wave function can be written as a linear combination of n independent functions. So over here we can write it down as the trial wave function phi is equal to c1 f1 plus c2 f2 like that till cn fn, okay. So this is what basically the linear variation theorem states. So using the linear variation theorem, basically we can find out the energy of excited states as well, okay, because over here we can make a secular determinant. A lot of questions do come on that fact, so I'll teach you how to make a secular determinant and how to find different energies, okay. One important factor that you need to know for a trial wave function, if you're writing it as a linear combination of different independent functions, then the greater the number of functions, the greater the number of linear independent functions, the better we are approximating the energy of the system, or the more closer we are to the original energy of the system. So the more the parameters, the closer we are to the original energy of the system for which we are approximating, okay. So now I told you in perturbation theory also, if you are trying to solve questions, and in variation theorem also, if you try to solve the questions, there's no way you can escape differentiation and integration. There's no way at all by which you can escape differentiation and integration. You have to do differentiation and integration, okay. There's no way, there's no escape to that, okay. Because let's say in the exam, there's you come across a question where a trial wave for a particle in 1D box, a trial wave function is given to you such that trial wave function says x into x minus l. This is the trial wave function that is given to you for a particle in 1D box, and they tell you how close it is to the original energy for a particle in 1D box. So the original energy for ground state for a particle in 1D box is h square upon 8 ml square. Now using this trial function, you need to find out how close we can get, or maybe in the exam they could directly give you a question that using this trial wave function, find out the energy of a particle in 1D box. Now you'll have to use integration differentiation, you have no other choice, and you have to use this formula over here, okay. You have to use this formula over here. So let's try and use this formula and try to find out the approximate energy of a particle in 1D box using this trial wave function. So first we'll try and calculate the numerator. So the numerator has the Hamiltonian operator. For a particle in 1D box, energy inside the box, the potential energy inside the box is zero. So the only kind of energy that we have is the kinetic energy. So over here the Hamiltonian operator for particle in 1D box is nothing but the kinetic energy operator. And kinetic energy operator is written as, kinetic energy operator is what? Minus h cross square upon 2m d square upon dx square. This is the kinetic energy operator in the x dimension, okay. This is the kinetic energy operator in the x dimension, and the trial wave function is this. So we have to do over here calculations. Over here we have no other choice, but we have to do the calculations. So let's try and find out the calculation, okay. Let's try and do the calculation over here. So first we write the function, the trial function that is given to us, x into x minus l, and the boundary conditions are l to 0 for a particle in 1D box. The boundary conditions are x l to 0. Then we have the kinetic energy operator minus h cross square upon 2m d square by dx square, and then we have again the trial wave function. Okay, so minus h cross square upon 2m is common, so we can take this outside. Minus h cross square upon 2m is common, so we can take this outside. So you take this minus h cross square upon 2m outside. So you take this outside. So now if you want to differentiate this, simply write it down as x square minus lx. Okay, you can just multiply this inside the brackets. So we are left with this, you can write as it is. And so this becomes, you can write it down as d by dx into d by dx. If you are not good with differentiation, you can directly write it down as d by dx into d by dx. And then this becomes x square minus lx. So if you take the first differentiation of x square, this becomes 2x. And if you take the differentiation of lx, this becomes l. So you are left with 2x minus l. So you have differentiated once, now you'll differentiate it again. So you have differentiated once, you'll differentiate it again. So d by dx of 2x is equal to 2, and this l is a constant, so this will become 2 minus 0. So we are left with 2. So this whole value comes out to be equal to 2. Okay. So we quickly write it down. This whole value comes out to be equal to 2. And what you can do is you can cancel out this 2 and this 2. Okay. The 2 on the outside and this 2 you can cancel out. So we cancel this out. So we are left with x into x minus l. Now you basically integrate this. Now x into x minus l, again I will tell you to multiply it so that it is easier for us to integrate. So x into x, x square minus lx. So this becomes x square minus lx. Now if you integrate this, this becomes x cube by 3 minus lx square by 2. Okay. Now if you see the upper limit and lower limit, the lower limit is 0. So if you put x equal to 0, both the terms will become equal to 0. So we are not concerned with the lower limit. We only have to consider the upper limit. Upper limit is l. So you replace x by l. So what do you get? L cube upon 3 minus l into l square. Again l cube by 2. So if you take the common factor is 6. So this becomes 2l cube minus 3l cube. So this is equal to minus l cube upon 6, right? And then on the outside you had minus h cross square upon m. So on the outside you had minus h cross square upon m. So basically what do we get in the numerator? In the numerator we get h cross square l cube by 6m. This is what we get in the numerator, h cross square l cube upon 6m. Okay, now let us try for the denominator. Now in the denominator what did we have? We had the same limits, x into x minus l. So we are multiplying the wave function twice, right? Psi star phi star into phi. Okay, so this is basically nothing but x into x minus l whole square. Okay, so basically you can use the identity. First open the brackets inside. So if you open it inside, this will become x square minus lx whole square. So this you can use the identity a minus b whole square. Okay, a minus b whole square, that is a square plus b square minus 2ab. So a square plus b square minus 2ab minus 2 into x square into lx. So this becomes 2x square into lx, 2x cube into l. So this becomes 2x cube into l. So you might be thinking it's very lengthy, but in reality it's very simple. Okay, I'm just trying to explain you, that's why it's taking me much more time. Now what you do? Now integrate this. So this becomes x to the power 5 upon 5 plus l cube x cube by l square x cube by 3, and integration of this becomes minus 2 x to the power 4 l upon 4. Okay, this is what we get. So you can cancel 2 and 4 out, so you are left with 2. Okay, x to the power 4 l by 2. Now if you take lower limit 0, so all have x terms, so all will become equal to 0. So we are not concerned with the lower limit, we will only take the upper limit is equal to l. So if you replace the x value by l, so this becomes, I'll write it down over here, l to the power 5 upon 5 plus L to the power 5 upon 3, all comes in L to the power 5, minus L to the power 5 upon 2. So you take the common factor comes out to be 30. So this becomes 6 L to the power 5 plus 10 L to the power 5, basic mathematics, okay, minus 15 L to the power 5. So if you calculate this, this comes out to be L to the power 5 upon 30, because this comes out to be 16 L to the power 5, 16 L to the power 5 minus 15 L to the power 5. So this comes out to be L to the power 5 upon 30. So now numerator also you have, denominator also you have. So you divide both of them. H cross square, you can write it down. H cross is nothing but H upon 2 pi. So you can write it down as H square upon 4 pi square L cube into 6 into this is 6 H. Sorry, this is how much? I've forgotten what I've written over here. I'm very sorry, I've forgotten what I had written over 6 M. Yeah, into 6 M. I can't even realize what I have written. I'm very sorry. That's how bad I write. And then we have divided by L to the power 5 upon 30. So you can take this 30 on top and you can take L to the power 5 over here, right? So 30 on top and L to the power 5 over here. So what are we left with? This is basically H square. And you can calculate, cancel this out. So this becomes 5 H square upon 4 pi square into L square. L to the power 5 and L cube cancel out, so this is left with L square. So you get 5 H square upon 4 pi square L square, and the original energy that we have for a particle in 1D box is H square upon 8 ml square, and I've forgotten the term M, so M will also come. So we are getting 5 H square by 4 pi square into L square into M. So if you calculate this, this comes out to be equal to 0.1266 H square by M L square. And if you calculate 1 upon 8 is 0.25, 0.125. So 0.125 H square by 8 ml square. So you can see how close, 0.1266, 0.125. So there's a error of about 1.3%. So you can see that how good our trial wave function is, that we got almost very, very close to the original energy, but we'll never get less than this energy. That is what your variation theorem suggests. So you can get these kind of questions in the exam. So for over there, this is very simple differentiation integration, nothing at all. It might seem lengthy, but it's very, very simple. Okay, now let's do some questions. This was also, this can be also one of the questions in the CSINET exam, but I have written down a couple of questions which are basically dependent on the secular determinant. Everything else I have explained to you, and most of the questions that you see these days in CSINET exam are theoretically based. Okay, they are theoretical. There are not many calculation based questions. Even from perturbation theory, you might have seen that I had discussed in the previous video, all the questions, they were very theoretical in nature. They are all dependent on the statement. So similar questions we have for variation theorem also, and let me read out some questions for you. So the first question that we have, one was this question that I just discussed, and then you can see this question on the screen over here, that choosing some Hamiltonian H and an orthonormal basis, a linear function is carried out to get approximate energies. So with two basis function, one obtains E12 less than E22. Okay, so with two basis functions, basically this is an example of linear variation theorem. So in linear variation theorem, I told you there's a trial wave function. We write it down as C1F1 plus C2F2, like that up to n terms. So two basis functions means we have taken only C1F1 plus C2F2, nothing else. Okay, and over here we got two energies. One is the ground state, which is denoted by E1 dash 2, which will obviously be less than or equal to the second energy level, okay, which will always be equal to or less than. If it's degenerate, then it will be equal. If it's not non-degenerate, then the second energy level will be greater. Okay, then it says taking three basis functions similarly. So three basis functions mean we add one more function over here plus C3F3. So if we take three basis functions, then it says that E13 is less than equal to E2, that is the second energy level, is less than equal to the third energy level. So the number of basis functions you take, then that many number of energy levels you will get. Okay, so if you want n energy levels, you will take n basis functions. If you want 10 energy levels, you will take 10 basis functions. So what is it saying? That the relation which holds true from the following is, so I told you originally only that the greater the number of basis functions, the closer we are to the energy, or the more closer we are to the energy of the original system. So over here we have three basis functions. So the ground state energy of this system will be lesser than this system. So over here we can say that the ground state energy of this system will be lesser than equal to ground state energy of the system for which we have two basis functions. And similarly, we can say that the second energy or the first excited energy of the system with three basis functions will always be less than equal to the first excited energy or the E2 energy of the system with two basis functions. So this, if you see, option number D only makes sense. So option number D is the right answer over here. Okay, very simple, just theoretically. And then there's another question that you can see on the screen right now. This question is based on secular determinants. So I've solved this question in detail on an academy, for which I'll give you a link down in the description box. So go ahead and watch that video. Okay, over there I've completely in detail solved this question. Okay, because I know that if I make a very long video, what happens is generally students don't watch it, and I want you guys to watch it, because this is one video where, you know, you'll get some clarity of concepts in variation theorem. A lot of you have a lot of doubts regarding variation theorem, so I'm quite sure that a lot of your concepts might have cleared after this video, right? And there are many more questions, but all of these questions I try and solve on Unacademy. The reason is quite simple. The interface on Unacademy is very easy for me. I just need to click a picture of the question and I could just solve it. Over here, I have to do a lot of editing to get the question over here, or even if I have to write it down on the board, it takes a lot of time. So on Unacademy, it just becomes easier for me. There's no other reason why I post questions on Unacademy. Okay, it's very, very easy for me to solve questions over there. So generally, I prefer teaching the theory part on YouTube, and I generally try and solve the previous year questions on Unacademy, right? So anyway, I hope you found this video useful. I put in a lot of effort for this. Like, I've taken out time and put in a lot of effort. So I really appreciate if you guys can give a big thumbs up to this video, and do let me know your comments on how you found this video and what else would you require from quantum chemistry, because almost everything I've covered in quantum chemistry, there are still a few concepts left, like virial theorem and maybe a molecular orbital and valence bond picture of hydrogen atom, right? So these are two or three concepts that have been left out by me. Rest everything I've covered. So what I'm planning to do is now making a playlist, so that all of you guys can have the whole quantum right from the basics up to this level in a playlist, and you can watch it whenever time permits you, right? So anyway, I hope you found this video useful. If you did, please give it a big like, and do not forget to subscribe to my channel. Thank you so much for watching.